Our next distinguished speaker is Dr. Ahmed Aldhaheri. Professor Ahmed Aldhaheri is a consultant dermatologist, acting dissection head at Cleveland Clinic, Abu Dhabi Hospital. He previously worked as a consultant dermatology in Tawam Hospital, Al Ain, Abu Dhabi, and at United Arab Emirates University. Professor Ahmed has many presentations and awards like clinical course of bullous pemphigoid patients with unique seropositivity to SBAG2 during the MEDIME conference 2018, and acute hemorrhagic edema of infancy case of presentation during the Dubai Derma International Conference 2012. He's a member of many professional organizations such as the advisory board of ABIV. So mashallah, is full of knowledge and experience in the field. Dr. Ahmed today is going to talk about JAK inhibitors in dermatology. Welcome, Dr. Ahmed, and the platform is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. First of all, I'm not a professor yet. Hopefully soon, inshallah. So I'm a dermatologist. So I'm not an allergologist, but I'll try to give you my experience in JAK inhibitors. So I have no conflict of interest for this talk. JAK inhibitors in dermatology, as a dermatologist, we are not very experienced with JAK inhibitors until recently. The only treatment we were using was tofacitinib, which is Xeljanz. We used it for alopecia areata universalis, although it did not have any label for alopecia areata. Recently, since last year, many JAK inhibitors were introduced to the treatment of atopic dermatitis, and they got FDA approval and EMA approval. So atopic dermatitis, it's a very known common skin condition. It's a chronic relapsing inflammatory skin disease with a complex pathophysiology, which is characterized by dry skin and itchy skin. The key cytokines which play a role in this disease are IL-4, IL-13, IL-31, TSLP, and IL-22, which are believed to drive the inflammation and cause itchiness and skin barrier disruption. The signaling pathway, on the other hand, are done through the JAK state pathway. So the risk factors of atopic dermatitis are very well known for every one of you. It's genetic, immunological, and environmental factors play a role. So we use many measures in clinical studies for atopic dermatitis to help us, guide us in diagnosis and monitoring and know the severity of the disease. And it helps us also to justify our treatments. So the first of the, one of the important measures we use is the EASI score, which ranges from 0 to 72. Another measure is the investigator global assessment. It goes from 0 to 4. We aim for our patient to reach 0 or 1. Another measure is the peak pruritus numerical reporting scale. We don't really use it in our daily clinical life, but it's important for the clinical studies to monitor the improvement of the patients. Also, the SCORAD and the DLQI. DLQI is, for me, is I believe it's very important. It gives us the quality of life the patient is having. In Cleveland now, we use it on a regular basis for every patient suffering from any chronic skin condition, psoriasis, atopic dermatitis, chronic urticaria, et cetera. We hand them the sheet with the DLQI for them to fill after they see the nurse. And then once the physician attends the clinic, he just makes the calculation and have an idea how the quality of life of the patient is impacted. So I would really encourage all of you to try it. You will be surprised that some patients who look nice, who look you know, doing well, but they will have a high DLQI 14 or 15. On the other hand, some patients who don't have have very low DLQI, they have really visible skin lesions. So the current management of atopic dermatitis, as we all know, it starts usually with topical treatment, calcineurin inhibitor, topical steroids. And then if it doesn't work, we usually go for phototherapy, methotrexate, et cetera. The last resort usually is the targeted treatment. Although now we are moving targeted treatment to a second line treatment after topical steroid because of various reasons. So the advanced treatment option for atopic dermatitis, we have two main arms, which are biological treatments and small molecules. The biological treatments we have are the T-helper-2 inhibitors. We have two options today available in the UAE. Dupilumab, which is an anti-IL-4 and anti-IL-13. It was introduced and launched in March 2018. And since then, it causes blooming really in the targeted treatments. All the rest of the treatments came after. And it causes a significant impact in the quality of life of the patient. A newer agent is the tralokinumab. It is a little bit more specific. It's only an anti-IL-13, so it targets only one cytokine. I think last week it was since last week I think it's available in the UAE. Small molecules, on the other hand, we have the PDE4 inhibitor, crisoborole, which is a topical treatment used for mild to moderate atopic dermatitis. And we have our talk today is about JAK inhibitors, which are the newer players in atopic dermatitis. So JAK inhibitor, we have three agents available today in the UAE, abrocitinib, baricitinib, and upadacitinib. So first of all, what's the difference between small molecules and biologics? From the name implies small molecules are smaller. They are usually given orally, and they only target the signaling pathway. Biologics are usually parenteral, and they are bigger molecules, of course. So in the pathophysiology, if we notice here, just it's a busy slide, but you see that dupilumab is targeting IL-4, IL-13, and preventing the differentiation of helper-2, whereas the JAK inhibitor is more about the signaling. So these are the three molecules we have today in the market, abricitinib, upa, and baricitinib. Numerous trials were done. Thousands of patients are involved in these trials. Most of the trials are monotherapy, so they compare the treatment with a placebo. Most of them have already trials for pediatric population. Interestingly, upadacitinib this is the only one with a head-to-head trial to dupilumab. Abricitinib, they have dupi as an active comparator, but they don't have a head-to-head trial. So, in terms of approval, this is a little bit outdated slide, but all of them have either FDA or EMA approval. All of them are registered in the UAE, and we can start prescribing them. So approval indication. Baricitinib is approved for rheumatoid arthritis and atopic dermatitis. Probably by the end of the year or early next year, they will get approval in alopecia areata universalis. Upadacitinib is approved for rheumatoid arthritis. So the rheumatologists, our colleagues, they use it, several years before us. Also atopic dermatitis, ankylosing spondylitis, and psoriatic arthritis. Abrocitinib has the label for atopic dermatitis. So in the warning and precaution, we need to treat this medication as we treat all other biologics we use for psoriasis. So we need to investigate patients before starting the treatment. We need to do the QuantiFERON. We need to give special attention for the venous thromboembolisms, and all the labs we require for the rest of the biologics. So we'll go in a little bit more details about some of these medications. The abrocitinib, it's given either 100 milligram or 200 milligram once daily. So the numerous trials are done. I will just focus on JAD mono 1 and 2. Both studies had three arms, placebo, every 100 and every 200. Patients were screened to have moderate to severe atopic dermatitis, and then they were randomized at week zero to 1, 2, 2, 1 for placebo, 2 every 100, and 2 every 200. And then at week 12, the primary endpoint was measured. The primary endpoint, we have two things, the IGA 0 or 1 and the EASI 75. So patient characteristics are comparable in all groups. Baseline disease severity is also comparable. So in terms of efficacy, and we are measuring here the IGA 0 or 1. Placebo is 7.9 of the patient reached 0 or 1, and then every 123%, every 243%. Similar result were noted with the JAD mono 2. EASI 75 over time, again at week 12, 62% of patients reached EASI 75 with every 200, 40% with 100, and 11% with the placebo. And similar result was noted with the JAD mono 2. The percentage change from baseline in the EASI over time, minus 28 with the placebo and minus 73 with the ABRI 200. Peak pruritus NRS 4 or more improvement at week 16. We can see as well significant improvement. And you can notice also that change in the dose causes a significant change in the effect. DLQI minus 9.1 with the ABRI 200, minus 7 and minus 4.2. So the safety profile, this is the most common side effect that happened with this medication. So we have GI upset and nausea, nasal pharyngitis, headaches, URTI. And in mono 2, similar side effects was seen, except acne was also noted. So moving to the upadacitinib is given either 15 or 30 milligram. They have many trials. One of them is the head-to-head trial with Dupi, 300 milligram Q2 weeks. I will talk about only the major up 1 and 2. So patient demographics and the baseline disease characteristics were comparable in all arms. Over time, over EASI 75, 80% of patients with UPA 30 reached the EASI 75 primary endpoint, 70% with the UPA 15 and 16% with the placebo. It's really impressive numbers. IGA, again, IGA 0 and 1, 62, 48, and 8. Improvement in the EASI score, minus 87.7, minus 80, and minus 40. Worst pruritus and NRS 4 points and above improvement, 60, 52, and 11. DLQI 0 or 1, 41 with the 30, 30 with the 15, and 4.4 in the placebo. I will skip the sleeping. So outcome in terms of safety, similar kind of side effects that's seen with abrocitinib. It's mainly nasal pharyngitis, URTI, acne, headaches. Again, this is with the major up two. So the last agent or the last molecule is the baricitinib. Baricitinib, we have many studies as well. They call it Breeze AD 1 up to 7. So the study was placebo plus topical steroid versus bari 2 milligram versus with topical steroid versus 4 milligram plus topical steroid. So they randomized them as 1-1-1 in week 0, and then they measure the primary endpoint at week 16. So percentage of patients who reached EASI 17 at week 16 was 48% in the bari 4 milligram, 43 and 23 with placebo. Again, with the NRS 4 or plus, we have 44, 38, and 20. Side effects. So the main side effects, again, nasal pharyngitis, diarrhea, this GI upset, and headaches. So still there is a risk of DVT, but it's not that significant. So just to compare between the JAK inhibitors, all of these medications are new. So really there's no studies that compare between one or the other. And also the studies which compare between, the JAK inhibitors and the dupilumab is very limited. We have only opetacitinib, which compares between them. So So if someone asks what's the best treatment option we can use, today we have many options. I would like to insist that we need always to look to the patient profile. For example, today we have medication that work, for example, for alopecia plus atopic. So if you have a patient with alopecia, you may consider to give, for example, Olumiant for in case of, for example, alopecia plus atopic dermatitis, or Rinvoq if the patient is having psoriasis with atopic, and so on and so forth. So taking consideration that this medication you'll need to do labs before you start the treatment. They are usually very well tolerated and safe. And they are really promising new tool for us in dermatology. Thank you for listening.